with what happened this afternoon, how good a nap you got, that kind of thing. And then get right to it. We're excited to be able to sing some really great songs for you tonight, some that'll stark and harken back some memories for us, and then a message again from the Sermon on the Mount tonight. And Brother Phil will come give the announcements here in just a second, but we will also be able to go over to Early Childhood Southeast Elementary and do a prayer walk tonight, because school starts for you guys tomorrow, right? Wednesday. Roscoe starts on Wednesday, and then, of course, Sweetwater schools start next week. So it is just about time, man. I'm telling you, even though it's still, you know, summer outside, summer is kind of, sort of wrapping up. We just need to clue in the weather, right, that it's kind of wrapping up. And a very wise man told me on Wednesday night that a meteorologist friend of his said the heat would break in mid-August. I looked at the long-term forecast, and he hadn't got the word yet. But we'll see, you know. I mean, the Lord can, you know, break that all up. Remember, the most rain we got last year was on the last day of August, or one of the last days of August, because coincidentally we were doing the back-to-school bash during that time too. So anyway, it is great to see you. Miss Alcyon slipped out somewhere, didn't she? Oh, there you are. You ready to start? All right. Getting her last drink of water. I'll get my mint. We'll have a word of prayer and get the praise team up here, and we'll sing some great songs tonight together. Let's pray. Father, we love you, and we thank you for the time together tonight. Thank you for the opportunity to be here in church and for what we'll be able to do ministry-wise after church tonight. And as we know the power of prayer, we are excited to be able to pray specifically for the upcoming school year and the teachers and the workers, the faculty, the staff. And we continue now to pray for those who are starting back this week, and the students that will be back in just a few days now. And we, as always, pray for our schools. And we know that that is a great mission field. And we are so thankful for those who dedicate their lives toward our students. And I pray that you would continue to prepare them, and that you will use them greatly in this school year. Thank you, Lord, for the chance to be in church tonight. I pray that everything that is said and done will be and bring honor and glory to you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's stand together. And the words will be on the screen to this one, because it's not in your songbook. It's Dwelling in Beulah Land. Let's sing first, second, and last verse. Here we go.
Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the Savior. I'm living.
because Christ arose. I know usually we only sing this on Easter Sunday, but I thought, man, we haven't sung this in a while. I love this song so much. Why reserve it just for Easter? Christ arose. Let's sing it together tonight. You can be seated. That's good singing tonight. We'll continue along that line, though. He lives, giving us great victory. We serve a risen Savior.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, He lives, salvation to
in all the world.
Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my stairway. He lives, salvation to impart.
Just the chorus tonight, because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Thank the Lord for His glorious resurrection. Here we go.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He
can say beyond a shadow of a doubt, it is well with my soul, right? It is well. Boy, we love to sing this song. We're going to sing it tonight. Here we go.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, it is well, it is well.
together.
And Lord, is the day.
Man, when things get kind of off this week, remember that. It is well with my soul. Man, thank you for your good singing. You may be seated, Brother Phil. Come on. Got some announcements for us tonight.
All right. August, with all of our stuff going on, it's heating up like the weather is. So we got a lot of things going on here in August, starting off tonight. Right after services, we'll head out over there to Southeast Elementary and the Early Childhood Center. And Brother David will go and he'll let us in. We'll be able to go through the hallways and just pray for the students, pray for the teachers, the students' families, that they'll have a great school year this year. So you don't want to miss that. And then also next Sunday is our promotion Sunday for our student ministries. We have some that will be moving on up into that next for a Sunday school class. And then also next Sunday is our 50-foot ice cream Sunday. That's right after the morning worship service there in the ambassador class. It was a little bit cooler. The ice cream should stay a little bit firmer so that way it doesn't melt as fast. And I did have a little quick question that's not on here. Are we having prayer breakfast on Saturday? Not yet. Okay. September. Okay. I just saw that. I had it in my head for some reason, so I just wanted to double check. Then also that next day on, as far as August 14th is, will be our Wings meeting for August. That will be Monday, August 14th at 7:30 p.m. So I know all the ladies, they look forward to getting the time together for good food, a time of fun and devotion. And then also on August 21st coming up is our new prospective member class. That will begin Monday, August 21st at 6:30 p.m. So see Pastor for more details. And we have our Faith Bible Institute, our elective. We have some little brochures back there on the Welcome Center. It is personal evangelism this time. That will start on September 25th at 6 p.m. And those are on Monday. And it'll be every Monday for about 4 weeks. So if you ever kind of get the thing, you know what, I would like to go and witness to somebody. I'm just not too sure. I'm not feel comfortable about as far as where to take them into the Bible. How to lead someone to the Lord. This would be a great class to go and to show you. And even those that are already know how, this would just be a great time just to be able to go and just kind of brush up and just because you can never get too much practice. You never can go and you never know how the Lord's going to lead and put somebody in your path. And so last day of registration is August 27th. Again, just pick up a bulletin as far as a brochure back there, fill it out, and then give it back to me so that way we can go and we can mail those back out. Also coming up in August, August 18th is our Cultivate Youth All-Nighter from 5 p.m. to 1 a.m. Those teens will have a great time with that. And then August 22nd is our softball game start back. I always say every year I'm going to lose some weight and I'm going to get in shape. And here it is again. Here's 2 weeks away or 3 weeks away. And I'm still not in shape. But we still have about 2 weeks to get in shape. So we'll see about that. And then August 30th, we closed out the month with our back-to-school bash. That's just a great time to be able to go and just help out the community. And so I do want to also, somebody asked about for his junior camp last week. I meant to mention this last week. I didn't get a chance to thank, as far as I know, Zach and Emma. They did a great job. They came with me and Holly to help out with sponsors. They did a wonderful job. I had Zach, he did one of the devotions on Wednesday night. He did a great job doing devotion. and just with the kiddos, and then as far as Emma, she did a great job as well. And kind of a funny story, back eight years ago, our youngest daughter, before we ever came here, she did an internship here at Broadway. Megan did. And she went to the junior camp, and no, she came back. We were living in Missouri. She came back and tell us about how there's a little girl named Emma. She was in third grade, and she caught a rabbit, and she put it in her pillowcase, and she was planning on taking it home, and Megan had to be able to go and try to convince her you can't take the rabbit home. And her and somebody, a little friend, kept getting food out of the cafeteria and trying to feed it and everything else. And so this year when she came, she went and caught another rabbit. And so, I mean, that girl, she is fast. And so I was asking her what the trick is, and she was like, you know what, you just got to get them, you got to chase them into a bush where they can't go nowhere, and then you just grab them. So if you have any kind of critters around your house, you know to go and check with Emma. She could probably go, and she could help take care of those things. But we are going, again, both those, Emma and Zach, both, they did a wonderful, superb job for us, helping us out. They're at junior camp. And so, again, we just want to thank you all for your prayers. And so that concludes all of our announcements. We'll go ahead and have prayer real fast. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, again, Lord, thank you so much for your love. Thank you just for the opportunity to be here and just for the blessings we've had just for this morning. And also just for the blessings of the Lord that already tonight, just that we've just been singing these praises to you, the Lord. And no matter what goes on in our life, we know you're there, and to be well in our soul, the Lord, and knowing that you're there with us. Lord, we just ask, Lord, just be with us tonight. Be with the men's group as they sing. Be as far as pastors who preaches, the Lord. Be with those that are listening. Just touch each one of our hearts tonight. We ask things in the most precious name. Amen.
Through my disappointment, strife and discontentment, I cast my every care on the Lord. No matter what obsession, pain or deep depression, I'm standing on the solid rock. I'm standing on the rock, on the rock of ages, safe from every storm. Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock. Even though he's gone now, I don't feel alone now. With comfort came the Spirit of the Lord. Now with his word to guide me, from temptation hide me, I'm standing on the solid rock. I'm standing on the rock, rock of ages, safe from every storm. All the storm that rages, rich in love I'm rich. Not from Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock. Now I'm pressing onward, each step leads me homeward. I'm trusting in my Savior day by day. And close is our relation, from is its foundation. So on the solid rock I'll stay. I'm standing on the rock, on the rock of ages, safe from every storm. All the storm that rages, rich in love I'm rich. Not from Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock.
I'm standing on the rock,
on the rock of ages, safe from every storm. All the storm that rages, rich in love I'm rich. Not from Satan's wages, standing on the solid rock.
If you'll do that, you'll lose weight.
Man, I'm telling you, 2 weeks. 2 weeks, Brother Phil.
If you'll do that, 2 weeks, you'll lose weight.
2 weeks. Two-a-days for 2 weeks. That's what we need to all probably. I've heard of messages chasing rabbits, but never kids chasing rabbits like that. I've heard of chasing rabbits for another reason, to kill them and eat them. But in fact, I was at a funeral service this past week, and one of the guys was talking. He asked if you'd ever eaten rabbit before, and I said, "Well, actually, I have, but it wasn't intentional." So when I was a kid, and I went over to my grandparents' house, and I get there coincidentally right at time to eat. Right, I'm a smart kid, and so there's always a plate, and here I go eating, and I'm like, "Man, Granddad, this is the smallest fried chicken I've ever seen in my life." He goes, "Well, grandson, that's not fried chicken." I go, "Really? Tastes just like fried chicken." He goes, "Actually, that's rabbit." And I said, "Ah, well, tastes like chicken. Here we go." I said, "Is anything that's fried that looks like chicken, I'm down." Right? I'm good. Matthew chapter 6, where we are in the scriptures, verses 19 through 21, we get to kind of shift the focus now in the master's class with the Lord. And in Matthew 6, 19 through 21, we get to experience the first little shift in thinking and teaching as Jesus continues to sit down by the Sea of Galilee and teach a mass of people that have gathered together in an amphitheater type situation, and gives us these fantastic words. In fact, from chapter 5, verse 3, all the way to chapter 7, verse 27, all the words in a red letter edition are red, because Jesus teaches this entirely in one literal setting. So let's read together Matthew 6, 19. Jesus says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through or break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Lord, thank you so much for your word. Thank you that we are able to open up your word and hear it read, read it for ourselves, and then listen to how your word should affect our lives. Will you use me as your speaker tonight just to speak exactly what needs to be said? May you use your word so faithfully to pierce our souls, divide us, convict us, teach us, and then help us, Lord, to follow your path of instruction upon understanding. And we're so dependent tonight on you, Spirit, to use this word, to use me, in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, there's a lot of things in this world that tie us down. Where you spend the majority of your week is at work. And so work can certainly have a way of tying us down. Consequently, we need to be very careful about why we're working, what we are doing while we're working, what kind of a testimony we are to our bosses, to those we're around, our employers and employees. But also, I think we need to realize that even though that's where we spend the majority of our time during the week, that we are actually a huge witness there in our place of work. And God has given us that opportunity and those people to work around on purpose. But we get tied down, if we're not too careful in this world, with things that really don't matter. And, of course, work can certainly do that. Years ago, I was tied or committed to doing Coleman Sports on the radio. Now, don't get me wrong. I loved every minute of it. In fact, when I was putting this little introduction together the other day, I was like, you know what? I think I still have some recordings of when I was doing Coleman football, and I have specifically saved on my phone some of the more exciting games that we were able to do. And so I was just like, I'm just going to listen to them a few. So I just got my phone out, and I started listening to a few of those little cuts and things, and I was like, man, that was so exciting. It was so fun. It was so great. It involved so much, and I love sports. You know, I love kids. You know, I love, our city. And so it was just a natural fit until it wasn't. It was all of a sudden, after a while, it really tied me down. I felt as if it was controlling my time, my effort, and our ministry and our family life 6 months of the year. Because it started, as you know, here in just a few weeks, football season will start. And at this particular time, when I was doing radio, I was already getting ready. I would go up and watch two-a-day practices and kind of get an idea about what the team's going to look like. I'd go watch a scrimmage to make sure that I knew all the kids' names really well. I would spend Thursday nights before the Friday night football game looking over the scouting report of the opposing team and memorizing all of their names so I didn't have to be looking at a program all night long and could just... and just describe it and tell it. So it took a lot of time. Friday mornings was all about putting together the introduction for the 30-minute pregame show that we did before. I'm exhausted just thinking about it. Not to mention, football games these days last like 3.5 hours, and I stood up to do these games. Man, I'm telling you, it was just a fun but very controlling time. And then the last 3 or 4 years... that I did this, I also did basketball. Now, we waited until district games started, which usually was in late December, early January, but here we go. So from like the end of August all the way till the middle of February, I am tied down, tied up doing Coleman Sports, committed to doing this. And again, I loved it all, but it just kind of began to be too much. Now, the extra money was nice. I'm not going to lie to you about that, because I was also able to sell the advertising, so I got commission off the advertising, as well as they paid me to do the games and stuff, so that was really nice. The kids really loved it back then, because I always, my little deal around Christmas is I always fold up some money really, really tightly and put it down in the bottom of their stockings, so they got to dig all the way through to the bottom. The older kids picked up on that really quickly, and when we're doing radio and stuff, I always had extra cash, and so I would just wad up like a $50 bill or a $100 bill in the bottom of their stockings, and so now you only get $5 or $10 since I'm poor again, and maybe a $20 if it's been a good year, and so they're digging up, and they're always, I can see it in their eyes, they're always a little disappointed. And even Bethany said it one year, she goes, well, we know Dad's not doing football anymore. Because, you know, things kind of changed a little bit. So, it was fun. It was fun to be able to give a little extra to the church, all those types of things. But in the end, I felt my heart was tied down to something that was actually hurting my relationship with Kim, my family, and our ministry. And I think we're all faced with battles like this. I think we're all faced with evaluation times or seasons where we need to pay attention to some things, and I think Jesus is hitting on some things. First of all, we're faced with a battle, the temporary versus the eternal. Almost every single day we're faced with this battle, the temporary versus the eternal. And Jesus puts it like this in verse 19 again, Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, where the moth, where the rust corrupts. Thieves could even break in and steal. Lay up for yourselves, though, treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, where thieves do not break through and steal. So we're faced with this battle, the temporary versus the eternal. Many times, this battle is derived from the visual versus the non-visual. Because we live in a world that unless we can touch it, taste it, smell it, we don't really believe it. We see, and we react upon what we see. That's the tangible, the visual. Where Jesus is saying, look, you lay up your treasures in heaven. That's invisible for right now. It's not very visible, except for some songs that might bring some really good visuals out. Do y'all remember the song, real popular back in the 90s, Thank You by Ray Bolts? Do y'all remember that? Adreno went to heaven, and while he was in heaven, a man came up to him and thanked him for the money that he gave, because the money that he gave got him to know or hear the gospel across the world, and he was saved because of the money that he gave to a mission work. I mean, that's the long and the short of that particular version. There's the thank you for some little kid that came up that he witnessed to or taught in the song. So we kind of get the concept a little bit, and that song and songs like that bring that to mind. But in the end, we don't really think about necessarily the eternal rewards every single day, do we? We're more or less just kind of plowing through, correct? We're more or less just dealing with the tangible, which quite literally Jesus is saying is the temporary. It's a struggle. As a result, or as result-oriented as we are, as we dwell in the temporary, we have the tendency then to develop a short-sightedness that blocks our view of eternity. Eternity is out there. It's coming. I know, if you've been in church for any amount of time, you've been hearing about this for a while now, right? And I know if you're anything like me, you get a little cynical and you're like, all right, Lord, you just forgot about us. I mean, it's bad enough. How bad does it got to be, God, before you come back and get us, you know? The reality is it's coming. We don't know when it's coming, but it's coming. Why is it coming? Because it's in God's word that it's coming, and God's word never lies, so we know that it's on its way. And someday, this that we don't see, that's not tangible, we will see. The Bible tells us that we'll actually be rewarded as we've laid up our treasures in heaven with crowns, and that we'll be able then to give those crowns back to Jesus, the one who made it possible to start with, to be where we are in heaven at the time. So these are the things that Jesus says is a lot more important to focus on. These verses might be some of the most applicable verses in this entire sermon series for us. Because as Americans in a free market society, making some money, having a little jingle in your pocket, is not terribly difficult. And the way the workforce is now, you can get a job if you're willing to work. And so we get just a little bit of something, and then all of a sudden we want a little bit more something. And then before long, the something is in control of who we are and our focus. When we get a little bit of money, it has a tendency to become what we think about. Then all of a sudden, our heart is tied to our money and the things we can do with our money and how we can accumulate our money, which, if we go right back to the reality of it, it's not our money. It's the money that, because God's the one who owns the cattle on a thousand hills, so it's all His. He's just letting us borrow it for a while. So we better use it wisely. And Jesus is obviously saying that if you start laying up treasures on earth, something's going to happen to it, right? If you have a closet full of clothes, guess what? I'm seeing moths everywhere right now. I had a towel draped over my golf bag the other day, and I looked down on my towel, and riding around with me on the golf cart was a moth on my towel. I was like, what is that? And he was digging in. And I brushed it away because I didn't know what it was. And lo and behold, it was a moth that had dug into my towel. And so I scraped it off in it. And I was thinking, oh, we're coming up on that message. That's going to be a good illustration. You know? Gold, we know, rusts, tarnishes. That is certainly true. I watch Iron Resurrection, which is a show where they put cars together and things like that. And the other night they had brushed a car all the way off and sanded it all the way down, and they said you can't touch that metal before it's primed, because it will leave a fingerprint or handprint on the car, and when you paint it, you will actually see that on there. Why? Because the metal was that is going to be that much affected by the outside air and by somebody touching it. Like, I was pretty fascinated by that, and I was like, that's going to be another good illustration of how that things in this world are corrupted or can corrupt very easily. Our focus, of course, becomes on the temporary, and Jesus reminds us that the temporary can be devoured very easily, very simply. Moth and rust are natural. They are attracted to our temporary treasures. So the do not of verse 19 becomes the do this of verse 20. Lay not, verse 19, but lay up for yourselves in verse 20 treasures in heaven. There's no moths. There's no corruption there. And the thieves, they can't get in and steal away heavenly treasures. They are then eternal treasures. Now get this. Things that are eternal that deserve our utmost attention. God. God is eternal, all right? And when I say that, I mean the Godhead, right? Jesus is still alive, okay? And the Holy Spirit is still real. So I'm talking about the Godhead when I say God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the triune God. God is eternal. Also, we note that the Scripture is eternal, the Bible. Okay? His word endures forever is what the psalmist says. And we also know this. The third thing that is eternal is your soul and my soul. At the point of death, our soul lives on forever somewhere. In heaven, if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and have trusted Him by faith to be our Savior, or in hell, if we have not ever believed on Jesus to be our Savior. So those are the three things that are eternal. So with what we are learning about here in verse 19, don't lay up your treasures on earth, because it's temporary, going to get stolen, going to get corrupted in some way. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, because those things are eternal. So we should then desire a personal relationship with God and develop, cultivate that relationship on a daily basis, because it's going to last forever. You know, I think about this often. What's it going to be like to see Jesus for the first time? Now, we know in the Revelation, you're not going to see God. You're just going to see the throne. Okay, because John tells us God's a spirit. So what you will see is Jesus when we get to heaven. And I'm wondering sometimes, will how close I am here on earth help me to recognize Jesus more when I get there. Because it would be a real shame if I was saved, but I never really cultivated a relationship with Jesus. So when I got to heaven, somebody had to grab me by the hand and go introduce me to Jesus. That'd be kind of a shame, wouldn't it? Because I really didn't know what his character was like. I really didn't have much of a close relationship with him here. Now he's my Savior, but that's about it. You see, if I develop a close personal relationship with my Lord, I don't think I'm going to be needing to be introduced to him when I get there, because I'm already going to kind of know him. And hopefully know him really well. I was thinking about this the other day, though. I can't help but think about that scene from time to time. And I was thinking, just because of some of the things that my mom's going through right now, I was thinking about what it's going to be like to get in heaven. And to get to Jesus for the first time. You know, because there's a lot of people I really want to see in heaven. I'm looking forward to that day. It's going to be a great reunion day. But I'm also, you know, first and foremost, I just want to go see Jesus, right? I want to get there to see my Savior face to face. And I was thinking, who would I want to take me to see Jesus? You know, it's already been there. Who would I want to take? And I was thinking about my grandparents. I was thinking about them just kind of grabbing hold of me and saying, "Come on, grandson," I don't know why this thought came to mind, but just skipping our way to see Jesus. You know, just skipping along the streets of gold, and here he is, Jesus, right there. I don't know what it's going to be like. I don't have any idea, but I will say this, that I think we should already have a pretty good idea who Jesus is before we get there. And that's only going to happen if we focus our attention on the eternal, not the temporary. Close personal relationship with God is going to last forever. When this happens, I think we're going to fall in love with the words he's preserved for us right here in his Bible. We should have a love affair with the scriptures. We should. We should hunger and thirst after righteousness, he said earlier. And the righteousness is found in the word. We should long for it. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. Psalm 42, 1. That's the way we should long. So when we want a close personal relationship with God, he's going to lead us, Holy Spirit generated, right to the Word. Okay? Then we need to fall in love with the words of God, which are also eternally and eternally preserved in his Bible. His Bible is then going to ignite a fire in our souls for what he loves. And what does God love? People. The souls of men. So that's what he's going to teach us here. His passion for people. From the Bible, we're going to learn that God so loved the world. From the Bible, we're going to learn that Jesus came to seek and to save them that were lost. We're going to learn that one plants and one waters the seed. What's the seed? The seed's the Word of God, according to the parable of the sower and the seed, right? The seed's the Word of God. So one plants the seed, one waters the seed, but God gives the increase. We're going to learn that from the Word. We're going to learn from Proverbs 11:30, and Phil mentioned it this morning, that he that winneth souls is wise. These heavenly treasures are safe and protected from any kind of worldly corruption. So the question we must answer is this: what is my heart tied to? Verse 21, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. What is my heart tied to? The temporary or the eternal? We all have things or people or jobs that we are tied to. In old Western movies, the cowboy rides up to the saloon, right? Hops off the horse and does what to the horse? Ties it up on the hitching post, right? They always have the really cool way of doing that. You ever notice that? there's just this kind of a real nonchalant little whoop. I guess it's from all those years of using a rope or something that they just kind of have a way with, and the leather's supple, and it just looks so cool the way John Wayne does that, you know? When docking a boat on a pier, there's those, I don't even know what they're called, those little anchor things that stick out, and somebody in the boat tosses the rope across the pier, or somebody jumps out of the boat onto the pier, and they get the rope, and they tie that boat up on the pier so it's not going to float away. Question is, what are we tied to? Are we tying ourselves to the temporary? Are we tying ourselves to the eternal? Would you describe your heart being tied up with the Lord the way He's describing right here, right now? Or not? Again, we can get our hearts tied up to various things. Could be relationships, jobs, hobbies. There are way too many of us in our world today addicted literally to social media. And in a former generation, hooked on TV. A pastor friend of mine one time told me, and he pastored in California, this explains a lot, that during Wednesday night prayer time, lady raised her hand and was asking for prayer for, I don't know, so-and-so, just whatever name. And the pastor was like, okay, can we pray? How do we pray specifically? You know, what's wrong? Well, she's having surgery tomorrow. Okay, what time's the surgery tomorrow so we can be praying specifically? She said, well, the soap opera starts at 11:30. I don't think that lady was tied very closely to reality. And sometimes the reality of what we're tied to is fictional. It's all going to go up in smoke if we're not careful. So what is our heart tied to, okay? That is, okay, when we say where your heart is, or where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. That is, the meaning there is our thoughts or our feelings. Where are our thoughts or our feelings tied most of the time? If our thoughts and our feelings are only on the temporary, let me give you a piece of advice. Live it up now. Live it up now. Because the eternal future does not look pretty for you. However, if we put our thoughts and feelings, and we might even add some of the previous verses, that way we tie it together from verse 5 and following, if we put our thoughts and feelings, adding in our prayers and our times of fasting on things eternal, then we got a lot to look forward to in eternity, which is coming. Back to the sports radio for a moment. I had to make a decision. Fact is, in my heart, my thoughts and my feelings, there wasn't a real decision to make. Because Kim came to me about 6 months or so before football started, and she was like, please don't do it again. Please don't sign up for another year. Well, in my heart, I had already been like, wrestling with the thought, wrestling with the idea. So when she comes and vocalizes that, I begin to realize, wow, literally, she said, I've been a football widow now for like 8, 9, 10 years. And I was like, well, that can't be any fun. I mean, there's only so many home improvement shows you can watch on Friday night, right? Alone. So I knew what I had to do. I knew that my heart's treasure, my thoughts and feelings were being led in an unhealthy direction. Was doing football and basketball on the radio a bad thing? No. Until it was. Because that's what I was tied to. And it was distracting me away from the things that were much more important. Even though my heart was in it at the start, it had become too much. It was distracting me from the main people and the main calling of my life. So, did a really hard thing. I stepped aside. So when I read words like this and I think back and I think presently, I think towards a future, these words convict me. Because we are so wrapped up in the tangible, temporary, rather than having our focus on laying up treasure in heaven for the future. These words convict me. Is your heart's interest what you think about most, what invokes the most feelings from you, only on temporary things? Or are you going to, after hearing a message like this, spend some time letting your heart's thoughts and intents, minds, stay focused on some eternal things for a while? I think we should probably do some sort of a scale in light of this and really kind of do a personal evaluation. How much time do I spend on things that don't amount to a hill of beans, temporary, versus how much time I'm spending on things that have eternal value with them? That's the challenge of these verses. And I pray that we'll take some time to evaluate this week. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to follow your leadership then when you speak. I know when you speak, you will speak clearly to us what your will is and what direction we should be taking in our lives. I pray that we would see clearly the temporary versus the eternal. And hopefully this message tonight has clarified some things. May we now act personally in the days ahead on what you have taught us and where you will lead us. And Lord, I pray right now that we don't just leave church tonight and forget. But Holy Spirit, will you continue to lead and to prompt us, to convict us, to bring these words to mind so that our hearts will be in the right place. Thank you for what you'll do. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, prayer walk time. We're going to meet over at Southeast Elementary. If you don't know where that is, tag along close to somebody that doesn't drive very fast or won't lose you going across town, okay? But let's go do a prayer walk tonight. Thank you. Dismissed.